Good evening all. So welcome all to this FOD Controls online awareness training. Why we are conducting this training program? So we are under this COVID-19 crisis. So we are under a lockdown situation. We have to maintain physical distancing, social distancing. We would like to utilize this time for upskilling, reskilling purposes. We are very happy to help you on this context. So we have launched a series of training. A few weeks back, we have started with the Automotive Quality Management System, IATF. Then we did one training on Medical Devices Quality Management System, ISO 13485. And also we did one more training on Railway Standard, ISO TS 22163. And we did 2 hours training program on AS 9100. This is what happened the first week of April. And last week, we have not conducted any training, and this week we have started with the 9145 APQP PPAP for aerospace industries. Then 2 days back we have a NADCAP introduction session, and today we are going to have it for FOD controls. So this training goes for 1.5 hours. We have small question and answer session, and also there will be online quiz. If you attended both quiz and the feedback form, next week you will receive a certificate. It's like a token of appreciation, but you have to get 60% mark for that. Okay, so all these trainings are conducted through the Zoom tool. I think few of you may have some concern whether this tool is safe to use. There are a lot of warnings, notification about this tool. With proper security controls and updates, it's very much safe. And we are not doing any video calls here. We are using this for only the training purposes. So we need not to worry about that particular safety aspect. So we are from Nucleus Consultant. We are into consulting, training, auditing services. We did around 550 plus management system consulting services. And we are strong in sector specific standard. For aviation, space and defense industry, we did around 300 plus projects, and we have a team of 6 people. We did NADCAP consulting too. So this is our solution with respect to aerospace and defense industry. So we are providing services to 9100, 9110, 9120, and also NADCAP consultation services, and also AS 13000 series for engine manufacturers. And we also provide services to automotive industries like IATF, core tools training, CQI, and all. And we have solutions for various sectors like railways, medical devices, telecommunication industry. So each industry having their own quality management system standard. So we provide training to them, consulting to them, and some generic standard like quality management system, environmental management system, occupational health and safety system, information security management system, right? We do all. So I'm Karthi Thyagarajan. I hold the lead auditor certificate of various standards, including AS 9100, IATF, Medical Devices Quality Management System, and many. I don't do audits, we do only consulting and training. That's what all about us. So what we are going to see today, a small introduction about what is this FOD. And what are the requirements with respect to FOD in AS 9100? And you might have aware about this standard AS 9146. This is a standard developed by IAQG. So we are going to see that what is there in that particular 9146, how to establish an effective FOD program. So this is what we are going to see today. So during this session, if you have any questions, doubts, queries, please make a note of it. End of this session, we are going to have Q&A. That time we will discuss, right? In between, I may not able to answer all your queries because the chat box is like coming with a lot of messages. So if you have any questions, please make a note. End of it, we are going to answer it. Maybe we can extend some time. I'll try to address all your questions, queries today. Okay, so this training doesn't make you a subject matter expert on this topic, but it will give you an overview. It will help you how to approach this particular standard or this particular FOD concepts. So that's what all about this session. Okay. So let's start with some basic terms. There are multiple terms we are using. FO, foreign object. Then we do use the word FOD. FOD, actually two things are there. FOD, capital D means it's foreign object damage. FOD, small D means it's foreign object debris. And if you look at AS9100, that also talks about a lot of foreign object requirements. Technically, if you read the standard, entire AS9100 standard, you cannot see the word FOD. They simply say foreign objects. Right, let's see one by one. Let's have a small discussion on what is this. This is the exact definition given in AS9146. What is foreign object? An alien substance or some article. It may be tools, consumables, it may be a hardware, even our personal protective devices, our personal belongings, any debris from your production, dust, environmental debris, it can be anything. The simple keyword is it's an alien, which is exist on your product. It has a potential, it may enter into your product or into your assembly, and it will become a foreign object debris. And potentially it may cause a foreign object damage if you have not removed it, if you have not controlled it. It's a big definition, but I'll try to split it into three sectors. The one is, it's an object, alien object. This alien object has a chance, it may enter into your product, and it has a chance, it may become a debris, and the debris can cause some damage. If you are not removed it properly, if you are not controlled it properly. So this is what all about the definition of foreign object. As such, the foreign object is not going to cause anything, but it has a potential, it could cause some damage. So this is the exact definition given in the 9146 standard. Then what could be foreign object debris? Any foreign object which has entered, the keyword here is, the foreign object lying on your shop floor is just a foreign object. If that foreign object entered or migrated into your product, or which is entered into your component or assembly or sub-assembly, then that could cause a foreign object damage. Again, if you are not removed it, if you are not controlled it, that is called as foreign object debris. For example, a small wire clip which is left inside in your PCB board. This is a clear example of debris, foreign object debris. It's an alien item. This particular small wire clipping is not in my drawing, which is not in my specification. It's alien to my product. If it is left inside my PCB board, that is a classic example of foreign object debris. Then what is foreign object damage? It's any damage. Due to that foreign object debris, the damage can be expressed either physically or even economic terms, which may create loss of monetary losses. And this could potentially damage the product or even system, and which will impact the safety or performance characteristics of the entire aircraft. For example, let's take the same example. The wire clip, which was left inside my PCB circuit board, it's a debris. If I not controlled it, if I not removed it, the entire circuit board may fail because that clip, which may create some short. That is considered as a foreign object damage. So we use this two terminology throughout this session. If you look at small d, FOD means that is debris. Capital D means that is damage. That is what the terminology used in AS 9146. So potential FOD, what could be the potential FOD? The condition where this foreign object degrees, which may cause some damage or failure. This is some of the examples. Wires, metal clips, solder balls, tools, hardwares, even ice, salt. If you look at the entire aircraft, the potential FOD is lot. Birds, animals, ESD, right? Anything alien to the aircraft, anything alien to the product, that is what FOD. It may have become a potential FOD if you are not controlled it, if you are not handled it. These are some of the terms I would like to highlight here. And 9146 has a few more terms. There is one particular terminology. I think most of you might have aware about this if you are doing ASD business, particularly with the prime contractors. They use this particular word, clean as you go. This is a simple principle, but the success of FOD control lies in this particular principle. It is a practice of cleaning the immediate your work area, and also cleaning of your product at planned intervals to eliminate the accumulation or migration of these foreign objects, which may potentially become a debris and it may cause a damage. So when you see something alien, it is the responsibility of every individual immediately clean that particular foreign object debris. So this is one basic principle this 9146 is enforcing us. That's what we use the word clean as you go. In various places we are going to use the word consumable. We consume a lot of consumables, right? When you manufacture, when you do assembly. Can you name some consumable what you are using in your organization, in your production process? Can you just type some of the consumables what you use? Flux, IPA, sealants, solder paste, consumables. Which means any materials, miscellaneous item required for product and required for my operation. This is consumed either during performing and work, even after completion work, you may discard that. For example, sometimes you use some covers, tapes, right? So after assembly, what happened to the tape? So you're going to remove it, right? That is also consumable, which means it goes with the product sometime, you consume, or sometime what will happen, you will remove it after using it. So this is what this particular definition of consumable. Yes, masking tape is one example of consumable. Then tools and are not considered as a consumable. You have mistaken that, like cutting tool, these are all not consumable with respect to FOD control I am talking about. So those are all coming under hardwares. Anything bill of material parts, here only we talk about standard parts, nuts, rivets, screws, bolts, right, keys, control keys, wire terminals. This is called as hardware. Housekeeping, we all know, we use this terminology in every industry. Either you use 5S methodology or 6S methodology, it's up to you. Adopt some basic housekeeping principles. Operation is exact work what we do. Assembly, manufacturing, right? Everything is considered as a operation. And personal item. In shop floor, what are the personal item you are taking along with you? Can you name some example? The personal item which you are taking along with you during production, during operation. Helmet, ring, PPEs, gloves, bike keys,
So a lot of things are coming up. So these items are either owned by yourself or even distributed by your organization for personal use. For example, your ESD controls, right? PPE, that is also considered as a personal item. Even though it is not your own item, it is given by your organization, but you have to consider it. Badge, ID card, stamp, right? We use inspection stamps, correct? So these are some of the examples, some of the terms I would like to highlight before reaching or before reading the standard. So what is there in AS 9100 with respect to foreign objects? So there are two classes which is addressed as a requirement, shall requirement. 8.5.1 says your production process must be performed under controlled condition. The controlled condition shall include prevention, detection, removal of foreign object. That's what all about standard demanding us. There is a three important requirement. You have to prevent the foreign object, you have to detect the foreign object, and you have to remove the foreign object. The same requirement is reflected in 854 preservation of product. So when you handle, when you store, when you process any item, it may be any stage, again there also we have to ensure prevention, detection, removal of foreign object. But if you look at the standard, there is one more place, but they addressed under a note. It is not a shall requirement, it is addressed under note. It says when you determining the requirement for product, it is the responsibility of the organization to determine the process of how you are going to prevent, how you are going to detect, how you are going to remove the foreign object. So these are the, some of the requirements which is there in 9100. But how to do this? Presently, what is the mechanism we have adapted to do this? There are three terms: prevention, detection, removal. So I'll put this way: how to prevent the foreign object? Is it possible to prevent a foreign object? Can anyone please respond? Prevention is possible. Yeah, that's what all about 9146. We must have a strong FOD prevention program. What is the content of that FOD prevention program? That's what the entire 9146 says. There are various ways which is developed by IAQG. So that tell us how to prevent the foreign object. Let's move to the next wording. Detection. Who will detect FOD? Who will detect the foreign object? Who is responsible to detect the foreign object? Soumya says QC, NDT, visual inspection. Okay, now my question is, okay, when you receive an item from your supplier, your inspection criteria, precisely your incoming inspection criteria talks about FOD inspection or foreign object verification. Okay, now I'll go back one step before that. If your incoming inspection criteria says I have to verify the foreign object on my receiving item, have you communicated this requirement to your suppliers? Which means you have to deliver an item without any foreign object. Have you communicated this? So now you relook, you are contradicting, right? Without communicating this requirement to your supplier, without flow down this requirement, how you are expecting that you are receiving an item with a foreign object? Okay, I'll go one step in advance. Whether your customer has communicated to you about you should have a process for prevention, detection, removal of foreign object. Did you got any such requirement from your customers? Through which document those requirements has reached you? If you look at your customer purchase orders, customer supplier quality requirements, yes, you are correct. So most of the prime contractor have a clear requirement in their purchase orders or in their supplier quality requirements, how to manage or how to control this foreign object. So the 9100 made it very clear, either you are a design organization or just a contract manufacturer or a service provider, doesn't matter. This FOD is an integral part of your entire quality management system. In ASD business, foreign object is very serious concern. Right? Standard just made it in a single line. You have to prevent, detect, remove foreign object. That's it. Okay, let's assume. Have you detected so far any foreign object? In your organization, you might have certified to 9100. I know some of my clients are here. Have you detected any foreign object? Very good. Have you detected it? Right. How you treat those items? If a foreign object is detected on your part, on your manufactured part, is this a non-conformity? It is a clear product non-conformity. Perfect. Let's see an example. You saw an hair on your PCB board. It is a non-conforming product. How we are going to deal with this? In a PCB assembly, we found an hair. You will remove it, right? Who will remove it? I'm talking about removal. Prevention, yes, you are wearing a head cap. When you do inspection, unfortunately, you found one particular hair on the PCB assembly. Now, I need to remove it, right? Who will remove it? Operator can remove it. You need to treat that item as a non-conforming item, right? Then, do you have any MRB process? Did you bring MRB in this? See, that in that aspect, you have to consider, right? Like I have to do clean as you go, so that shall I remove this hair? An operator can do that, means again it creates further damage. So the risk based thinking is very much needed when you establish this FOD control process. 9145 emphasizes. Okay, so let's move further in this regard. So this is a very major concern in the entire industry, aviation, space and defense industry. There are a lot of information available. If you go to Google and search FOD, you get a lot of information, lot of guidelines. But IAQG come up with their standard, the industry come up with their standard. We all know what is IAQG. So they come up with a beautiful standard, that is what 9146. So it's all talks about prevention program, FOD prevention program, and how we need to flow down this through your suppliers. Most of the time your customers simply say you should adopt AS 9146 to control FOD, or equivalent to that there are some standards your customer may refer that. For example, there are some more standard, military standard is there, even NAS 4 tool is there. Have you came across these standards? So it depends on your customer contractual requirement. They may refer either follow 9146 or follow NAS 412 or follow MIL standard. So it depends on the customer methodology. They flow down this requirement to you via contract. So what 9146 says, it gives some basic requirements, a standardized methodology, so that entire supply chain can able to mitigate the FOD risk. And finally, the aim is to achieve customer satisfaction. This is what a simple introduction about 9146. Okay, so have you seen this type of posters? Are you using these posters in your organization? Yeah, the color, size, font, you can customize on your own. There is no standard. You have to use the same thing. Yeah, typically we use these type of terms, right? FOD awareness area, FOD control area, FOD critical area. So what is these three different areas? Typically, FOD awareness area is like a fabrication area, even maintenance area for MRO industry. Within your facility, which needs some action here. For example, we have discussed clean as you go. There are some FOD barriers will be there. When you're not in work, you put that particular barrier. So this is typically called as FOD awareness area. Then FOD control area is like a bit sensitive area. Here still you need to have a clean as you go. Still you put some barrier if you are not working or even working. But here the no food or drinks are allowed. And you have to identify this area with clear visible marking or some poster. Sometimes use some dress code, right? Here you have to enforce no jewel policies and all. Then FOD critical area, the name itself says what it is. It's most stringent. Maybe sometime here we need a clean room control also, right? So it depends on the risk you desired within your organization, within your manufacturing area, which are the area you are going to declare. This is an awareness area, this is a control area, this is a critical area. So why FOD is important? The failures due to FOD cause loss of life. And it is not just with the human life, it goes beyond that. Sometimes what will happen during war zone, the critical communication data transmission links may get failed because of a foreign object. Reputation will go if you send an item with a foreign object, even though if you maintain 100% on-time delivery performance, zero defect, but if you send a foreign object, look at your image. And any incident, safety incident is proven because of your poor FOD control. It has a lot of financial impacts on your organization. You're liable for it. So FOD always has a lot of risk, lot of risk. So it is not just to end with money. It results in injury, sometimes death also. Let you think this way. How would your life will change if FOD can go and kill someone? You could have prevented it in advance or during your inspection stage. So this mindset we should have. So it's all up to us. Every day, every minute, if you want to stay in this aerospace defense business, you have to take FOD personally. Think if a surgeon who leaves a sponge inside a patient, there's no difference than you misplaced a foreign object on an aerospace system or subsystem or an aircraft or an assembly. So you are personally responsible for practicing FOD prevention, whatever you do in your business. Whether you just an engineering process or you are in stores or you are in production or quality, doesn't matter. You have some role in this. Okay. Let's give me some example. What could be an FOD? Can you name some FODs? I'm just going to read whatever you're going to type in the chat box. Let's understand what is your interpretation. Scrap is not as such SOP. If scrap on you entered into a product, then that is a FOD. Hair, okay. Bolts, perfect. Dust. Cloth piece, birds, tape, bottle cap, water drops, rust. Perfect, perfect. Okay, let's see some pictures. What can be an effort? Look at this. You heard about this particular news? I think most of you might have aware. Wrong belief, superstitious, that can become an effort. If you throw some coins inside the engine, look at this. The impact. Right? This is on operational front. Look at MRO front. Everything a person can wear has disappeared into an engine at some point of time. I think some of the MRO personnel are in this participant group. You might have well aware about this, right? What you might have seen. Buttons, bells, pens, lot of items, right? Which was found in an engine. Look at the location. An engine. Sucked bolts and nuts. That has become an FOD again. This is on the track, on the field, on the operation, on the runway. Tools, as you mentioned, maintenance tools. Accountability, tool accountability is one of the critical factors. Like as we discussed, clean as you go, similarly, tool accountability is also one of the critical success factor of FOD control. Even frogs. So this is on operational front. Even cleaning cloth, this may be happened on the production assembly front. We do have a process called as part cleaning, right? On machined part, let's apply this on a machined part. Do you have a process called as cleaning of your precision machined components? And what is the methodology of cleaning? How you clean those parts? Can you give some examples? Ultrasonic cleaning. Yes. If your customer defines a methodology, you adopt that. Compressed air, IP. I'm talking about machined component, air blow. Using cotton waste. Pickling, three tray methods. Good. So a lot of processes are coming up. So ensure your cleaning process doesn't cause or doesn't leave any foreign object into it. Then assembly area, it's very critical. The tool, the tray, what you deal with that. The personal behavior, the location. So everything is contributing something with respect to this FOD. When you use some blasting process, right? What is the abrasive media you are using? Short peening materials, burrs, chips, water droplets, sealant material. If you remove some sealant material, the fine parts, right? If you apply a material shortage, in that shortage space, there may be some dust or some other particle may go and fill it up. While operation, that creates a lot of damage. So these are some of the examples. Even look at the oil. Sometimes we apply greases and oils. We ask only one question. Is it specified in your customer specification? Is it alien or not? That's what all about. We have seen the definition, right? An alien. Look at these examples. Packaging debris. Sometimes we'll write down in the file, right? That itself is a foreign object. If you mix up the material, it looks like similar, even though it is identification traceability purpose, but here it is a foreign object, right? So these are some of the examples. screwdriver, sockets, cables, tie straps, name tags. These are some of the examples which is already observed in the ASD industry. Either it is observed at your customer end or it may be observed at MRO stations. We have discussed now personal items. Sandpapers, glue, consumables. So this is one of the case study. This is actually L3 organization's case study. Trimmed wires, solders, that will become an FOD. That causes very serious damage for them. Even the cutting tools, damage, if you use the damaged tool, there is a risk it may become a, it will create some foreign objects that will become a debris and that creates a damage. Yes, Satish, you are correct. The sweating drop, water drops. This is another example at MRO. At the operation ground, it cost almost $20 million combat aircraft was lost because of this a small wrench tool. This is a real time incident. But it is not just the property, look at the life. This is the example you might have seen from IAQG. These are the pictures taken from IAQG itself. These foreign objects are observed at MRO station. And this is a production site. The product reaches the customer returned the item. The inspection wise, dimension wise, it is perfect. But there was a foreign object there. Debris is there and it may cause a damage if the customer send this item to their customers and it assembled in an aircraft. Tomorrow it may become a foreign object damage. Okay, the fabrics, we have discussed this a lot, right? The nylon fibers. Even metal chips. If you do assembly, then you have to do an all different approach with respect to FOD control. No, I'm just doing machining means visually we can able to control it. Even that on the machine part, how complex your product design is. It has curves, bends, visibly we cannot able to see with naked eye. So those type of things, again, you have to do a different type of risk assessment. If these FODs are not detected and removed, obviously this is going to create a lot of damage. Food items. Yes, Deva Prakash, you are correct. Cleaning brushes, crystals. Correct. That's why accountability of hardware, accountability of tools is very critical in FOD control. You can always question your process. What is the methodology of our kitting process? For each work order, you got a relevant item from your stores. What is the process of access? Who is going to issue those materials? In case of any shortage, in case of any excess material, you have to seriously investigate this each, every incident. You just go back to your organization, look at your workplace. Is there any unwanted item exist? Is there any excess item is there? Then obviously you have to relook your entire FOD control process. Then tool accountabilities, right? The tool has a lot of screws, levers. This is another classic example from IAQG. Small broken metal piece causes a huge damage. And this is another FOD. This is with respect to product safety. FOD is not just going to like prevention, detection, removal. It has some contribution to product safety also. Look at here, 0.8 mm of some foreign object impurity causes the engine failure and that damage the entire engine. What would be the cost of this material? What would be the cost of the engine? So you have to apply this risk-based approach when you establish FOD control program. Now, we'll discuss something new, FOD. COVID-19 itself is a foreign object, right? For as a humans, for us. Okay, so now most of the organization for COVID, we are under lockdown situation, correct? Now, if you go back to your shop floor, once the lockdown is over, when you start the production, the risk is too much high, right? So a lot of foreign object might have accumulated on your product. If you go back to your stores, you go back to your shop floor, in-process items, items at your supplier end. Look at the aircraft, MRO industries, how they are managing. There were more than 16,000 passenger jets are grounded worldwide as on today. Because most of the aircrafts are not flying, right? Because of this COVID crisis. And finding the right space to park those aircrafts, it's a serious concern now. And it is not just parking them, they have to make sure it is airworthy, right? It's a very critical concern. We can't just like that remove the dust and run an aircraft. It's a serious business, right? Humidity. The humidity is the biggest concern. It corrodes a lot of parts, right? It can damage interiors. So yesterday, there is one good article published by Bloomberg. I've taken a few pictures from that. That gives you some idea how serious this FOD is. Look at this. These jets are just parked somewhere in the runway. May not be appropriate parking slots. In India, the parking slots are very expensive, right? And how they are managing, they have to control, right? FOD is not only at the manufacturing end or not only at the design end, its entire supply chain is playing some role. And look at this, it's completely covered. So it's block insects and nesting birds. So when you go back to your workplace, relook. Either you may manufacturing a small product, small component, doesn't matter. FOD is matters to us. I think there was one picture available. They have removed it. I don't know, maybe fake picture. This is yesterday news. There is a snake which was observed in a Air India aircraft, Bay number 89. Okay, now. Who is responsible for FOD control in your organization? Everyone is responsible based on the risk. If you found any FOD, it should be reported immediately. That is very critical. Top management commitment is very critical here. The facility manager, do you have a management representative for FOD? Or the QMS MR, management representative, is the authority, having authority for FOD. What is our present mechanism? Not talking about AS9100 management representative. I'm talking about FOD management representative. So you consider that option. Depends on the risk again. I'm not saying that you should have appointed a separate FOD MR. So some of the impacts of FOD, it can be unimaginable failures, unplanned landings, premature wear of seals, and that cause a lot of leaks, premature wear of internal components if you leave FOD as it is, landing gear failures, So what not? You can keep on adding what is the impact of this. But what I would like to emphasize through this training program to each and every one, it is responsibility of entire life cycle, the designers. When you purchasing, when you manufacture it, when you ship it, when you does the maintenance, repair, overhauling, everyone is playing a vital role in FOD prevention. What they will do, how they will contribute. Let's take designers. When you design, you have to consider various aspects. Is there any level areas where foreign object can accumulate? You consider that while designing it. Like flat pattern, some large holes. When you design, you consider, is there any product feature where a foreign object can nest or collect it? Like some groove, blind holes. Is there any compartments, cavities, passages are limited for visual or physical access? So designer has to consider all these aspects. When you designer making any bill of material, what are the consumables you are going to use here? Bonding agents they are using, what is the methodology they are going to apply this? Any blind assemblies are there? So the various aspects designer has to consider. And purchasing, we have discussed this, right? When you place a purchase order, when you select a supplier, consider all these aspects. Whether your supplier has a process to address this FOD. When you do supplier audit, consider the FOD controls, right? Then when you do production, when you do assembly, you have to be take care of a lot. Do a proper risk assessment for FOD controls. Then apply the adequate controls. Clean as you go, tool accountability, training. So there are a lot of controls exist. So all the controls may applicable to you. So depends on the risk, you have to consider this. Then shipping. So most of the time what will happen, we'll put all the controls. Just go and look where you keep your packing materials. Do you have a separate storage location for packing materials? So most of the time I can see packing materials are stored near the scrapyard. Or at least near non-conforming item. So don't do that. Right? So before shipping, make sure you have a process for visual inspection for FOD. Based on the risk you decide, do I need to use some boroscope? Do I need to do some X-ray or some other NDT? Right? So based on the risk, you have to apply all the controls to prevent or eliminate the FOD in your process. So it should blend with your blend. Don't expect some auditors or some consultant or your customers come and say, no, no, why you have not considered this FOD? So you have to do a detailed, thorough risk assessment. So the success of FOD prevention program lies on these three pillars. Top management commitment is very crucial here because FOD controls needs a lot of investments, resources, a cultural change. So we need a top management support, commitment there, otherwise it's not possible. So they have to demonstrate their leadership here. Then every individual active participation, accountability has to come into picture. And it, you have to consider this a personal. It's your purely a personal. Right? This will is one of the success factor, I could say. So when you wanted to establish a proper FOD prevention program, make a process, document it, have a procedure or SOP. Cover that in your internal audit. Cover that as consider that as a process. It's a separate process. So these are the various elements of FOD prevention program. There are seven elements: operations,
area designations, training of your personnel and access of those personnel, product protection, housekeeping and clean as you go, accountability of your consumables, hardware, personal items, and tool accountability and control. These are the 7 basic elements of a robust FOD prevention program. So all your FOD prevention program must be documented. You have to evaluate whether your documented process is effectively implemented. In case of any foreign object is detected, how you are going to treat it? Are you going to treat it as per your control of non-conforming process? Apply controls based on your risk assessment. Flow down these requirements to your supply chain. This is very important. Communicate the effectiveness of your FOD controls to your customers, to your operators. Even this needs to be reported in your management review. So far, what are the debris or what are the damage we came across? So this is one of the best practices which is required for FOD prevention program. This is AS 9146 requirement, shall require. Then do it continually. So the first step when you want to do FOD prevention program in a systematic way, the first step is do your risk assessment, review it, check with each and every process owners through a gap assessment, check with the design, purchasing, production, stores, quality everywhere. Then develop a mitigation plan, implement it, and reassess it. Right? Then we see 7 elements, right? So these are the 7 elements. How we are going to deal with these 7 elements? First, establish a process. Consider it during design what we need to consider. Protect your personnel, product, process. Have a workflow. The sequence of operation, right? What is the first operation? Where is the location of your second operation? And where is the exact physical location of your third operation? Layout, how you make it. Then make sure you have a capability for cleaning the part, to do this visual inspection, to do this FOD inspection. Do you have adequate resource? Then detect it. So these are the 6 requirements for operation. Consider this when you establish a program. Then area designation. We have seen now FOD awareness area, FOD control area, FOD critical area, correct? So based on the risk assessment, you determine which are the area it is. So each area, what type of control you want to establish? No, this area, no operators without proper training, without competency are not allowed. Even though they are within the organization, within your employer, your payroll, but make sure they have not entered into that particular critical area. And each area should be identified with proper color code. Right. So when you do this type of identification of area, create awareness to entire supply chain, particularly the housekeeping personnel. Don't leave them. What will happen? We will apply all the controls. We'll give an access card even in this critical control area. Only trained, competent person can only enter it. Whereas we'll give access for housekeeping personnel to enter everywhere in the shop. So this type of risk we need to avoid. Right. Now, in your product assembly area, who are all having access? Can you please answer this question? In your final product assembly area, first of all, do we have any access, physical access restriction? Yeah, good. But who have an access to enter that particular area? For example, a visitor wants to access your FOD critical area. Even customer wanted to visit your FOD critical area. Do you train them on FOD or you escort with a qualified, competent person along with him? So these type of processes we have to consider. It is not just identifying an area. It is how you are deploying the controls. Right? Then the very important requirement, training of personnel. I think this training program is part of that. First, you determine what is the content of the training. Every organization, do we have a separate training module for FOD? If not, please create. You have to create your own FOD material. You can get some guideline. Even 9146 gives you some basic guideline. But you walk around your workplaces. Take a camera. Take photographs. What are the FODs? If you go and relook, I'm strongly tell you there will be, you can get minimum 10 or 20 foreign objects. It may become a debris. It may create a damage. Doesn't matter. So try to use those examples, live examples from your industry. Even most of the time when we do go for a consultation services, my clients will ask you, sir, give me some FOD examples. I'll say, no, I'm not the right person to give you the example. You go and ask your operators, look at your shop floor. Put your shop floor, make a circle, stand in that circle for an half an hour. I'm sure you will identify 10 or 20 FODs. That's the best way to identify. So make sure what is the training content and identify all personnel whom you want to train. Operators, supervisors, housekeeping personnel, security guards. Correct? Then what is the methodology of training? It's like during on-the-job training, we will train all my employees on FOD. We will give an exam. Whoever clears the exam, we will clear them. But okay, fine. How frequently are you going to redo this training? You can go and relook. If you have FOD training material, okay, fine. What is the version of it? When you have revised it? Right? So you define the criteria. When to train, how to train, whom to train. Then verify the training effectiveness, not just by asking some question or exams. Go back and relook their performance, on-the-job training evaluation. And prove it, everything. Right? These are the best way to adopt this. So here I'll give some matrix. Can you just tell me this? For example, who is responsible? If, for example, internal. All your internal employees are trained on FOD prevention, right? Okay, if a visitor comes to your organization, who will escort them? Because operator is busy in production, right? Who will escort a visitor? Some admin guy, very good. But whether the admin guy is trained on FOD then? See, ensure always the competent personnel are escorting them. Okay, have you given training to your suppliers on FOD? I'm not sure all your suppliers are enough competent to understand what is FOD, what is the consequence of FOD. You may flow down this requirement in the purchase order, but periodically you have to train them also. Right? So during training, you consider various aspects, how to store, how to ship the item, what are the techniques to control the debris. What is housekeeping? What is this clean as you go? How to ensure the accountability? Right, on various aspects you have to train them. Then your product protection, material protection. So establish a process first of all. Get the material MSDS. As per MSDS, you have to store, preserve the material that is there always. But protect against the contamination. How you are going to keep it with bags, caps, or are you going to use some covers? There is always a question, machined component, right? When you have a precision machined components, how you are going to handle the component within your organization? From machine 1 to machine 2, is there any special tray you have designed to prevent FOD? When you are sending this item to your suppliers, what container you are using to ship them? So each individual item is wrapped with some protective cover. Ask all these questions.
then prepare your FOD prevention program. Then cleaning. Okay, very good. You are doing all the cleaning in a systematic way. How about your supplier end? Whether your supplier is having any cleaning mechanism, whether they do UV cleaning or some IP cleaning, whatever. Have you clearly communicated the cleaning requirement other than the product specification? Right? So these are the various aspects we have to consider. Then do audit, periodical audit. You do have a QMS audit, that is fine. In addition to that, you can conduct FOD audits. You should have a policy on the shop floor. If someone see a foreign object, not on the product, I'm talking about on the shop floor, what you need to do? So there should be a policy. If any item I have seen, you should have a place to pick and drop those items immediately. Don't expect it is not my responsibility. Or you inform the operator, okay, there is an item, you just pick up and put it there. No, you can't say that. You have to do it. I have already mentioned that, right? You have to take it personally. Yes, exactly. And the loose parts, how you are going to handle, that is always a critical factor. That in assembly shop, if you handle a lot of part numbers, a lot of customers, the hell lot of items are there in your workbench. So how we are going to deal with it? So this is the way you have to address this product protection. Then this housekeeping and clean as you go. So emphasize that to every individual. If you drop something, pick it up. If you see something drop, pick it up. If you hear something drop, find it or report it. So this will become a mantra for you. I'll repeat it one more time. You paste it in your shop floor. Train your team. If you drop something, pick it up. If you see something drop, pick it up. If you hear something drop, find it. No, it take too much time. At least report it to the relevant authorities. So every employee must clean their work area prior to start and work. Whenever the debris accumulate, that time I have to clean. When the operation cannot be continued, in between there is a break, tea break or lunch break or bio break, I have to clean. And after an operation is completed and prior to inspection also I have to clean. Of course, end of the each shift I have to clean. So you please go and ask your operators, what is the frequency of cleaning? Have you defined it? I'm not talking about part cleaning. I'm talking about FO, foreign object cleaning. It may vary operator to operator. So you should standardize it. Right? So define this interval based on the risk. You decide the intervals. So when you found an FO or FOD or FOD, mitigate it. So keep your workstations neatly organized. Again, how frequent you're disposing the FOD bin. If you keep on accumulating lot of FOD in it, that become an FOD again. Right? So conduct regular FOD walks or FOD audits. Then consumable, hardware, personal item accountability. We have seen what is consumables, what is hardware, right? So kitting is always a critical task here. Stores personnel is very clear, whatever required for that particular contract or particular work order, that item only will be issued, right? Now, the most of the time, what is happening, the excess item, shortage item, each time when stores personnel has came across these type of requests, they have to investigate this. There is one more class in AS 9100, accountability, right? So that is connected here. So all consumables, it may become a FOD. If you
not properly controlled it. Consumables and all. Sometimes we will give you the consumables to the shop floor. They will keep it. They will use it. We'll deliver it as at a primary container itself. So what type of control you are exercising within the shop floor? Because stores may not be able to control those type of items. Correct? So we have to ensure the tool accountability, where you are keeping your tools. What is the frequency of cleaning your tools? What is the methodology of preserving the tools? Right. So have a process, kitting, sorting, labeling of your hardware. So give proper trays, proper place to keep these items. So employees must actively engage on this activity. Every incident, every near miss foreign object also must be reported. And some of the best practices I would like to highlight here. In your organization, make a FOD squad. That is always the best way. Include team members at all levels, not only at a supervisor or even inspectors, include operators also. Try to engage volunteers for this squad. You don't go and pick the people. Let people become volunteer to this, because that creates some ownership. And slowly they will become subject matter experts on FOD. And they will be the focal for the entire area. They will advocate the FOD processes. Right? And you do cross audit. Send this team to other shop floor or other work area to have this FOD squad process. Then perform a detailed walkabout. Again, the squad has to do this. But be critical on this. When you found an FOD, take a photograph, then pick it up, because that will become a lesson for us later. Report each and every fault, every foreign object detection. Right? Don't wait, people like us come and say, no, why you have not controlled this. Follow procedure strictly. Never ever forget this, clean as you go. Account all your tools, hardware, equipments. Where possible, based on the risk, based on your customer contractual requirement, use X-rays, boroscopes, right? Where we can able to visibly check the items. Train all, including housekeeping, personnel, contract labor, securities. Not just FOD, what would be the cause? What, how is it going to impact the product? On that context, you have to train your team. The designated area should be clearly marked. The item should be kept in the same places. So try to watch what is happening in the industry, how they are controlling the FOD. A lot of best practices shared across the internet. You can always search and try to adopt the best practices. Okay, so these are the some of the things I would like to highlight here. And one more information, I think most of who are attending this session seriously, they are aware about this. We are conducting internal auditor training for various standard. Next week, we are going to have AS 9100 Revision D internal auditor training. It is 3 days training, 21st, 22nd and 23rd, every day, 5 hour training. It starts from 11 o'clock and ends with 5 o'clock. In between, 1 hour break is there. It's a detailed training. There is no compromise between a classroom training and this virtual training. The same content, same material, but we'll give more time here, 15 hours. If you're interested, you can just check with us. The same link, whatever you have used to register this program, use the same link to reach us. It costs 2,500 head per person. Okay, so here I will show you a small quiz. You need to attend this quiz. I'll paste the link in the chat box. If you can able to click this link and attempt, means fine. I'll give you 5 minutes time for this quiz. If this is not the link is not working, copy this particular link and paste it in a browser, then the link will open.
Just try to attempt this quiz. That will give you some more fair idea about FOD. Then we will move for question and answer. If the link is not working for you, don't worry. I will type that link one more time. Right? Yeah, is it visible now? This link is working for anyone?